He did not choose a successor for only that one party's family. However, he chose a successor for another branch of the family. What is fairly certain is that MRA appears to be a strong enemy who enjoyed the support of the people of Ilorin. In spite of this, the MRA was forced by Balogun into accepting the Balogun's military campaign against of after the Jalo Reform of 1878. If the misunderstandings between MRA and both Balogun Reform and later Balogun were not to undermine sufficiently the position of the MRA, these are results of the Balogun in terms of contestation of political power. The most decisive show of power was that between Emir Momo 1891 to 1895. This crisis has attracted some attention. But any analysis of power politics in the law in the 19th century is not complete without a brief mention of the power struggle that caused the Emir his life. The Balogun did not like the policies of the Emir, who, as soon as the ascended the throne in 1891, believed that he should improve the law in relations with Iba and the rest of the empire. The Emir was also of the opinion that Ilorin should maintain friendly relations with the British invaders. The Balogun were unanimous in their opposition to the Emir's position on these matters. Rather than the Emir towing a line of caution, he was bent on following his line of thought, forgetting that the honors lay in the hands of the Balogun to determine what the first was good for the enemy. After a face off with the Balogun for a week, the enemy reported giving himself up in the palace. Since the creation of the office of the Balogun, the struggle for power between the emirs and the Balogun reached a high watermark in 1895. The intervening years between 1895 and 1900, when Sulaiman was the Emir and the eventual fall of Ilorin to the force of Royal Niger country, the Balogun of Ilorin enjoyed powers that had no parallel in anywhere in the Sokoto Caliphate. War was essential to the success of the Emir in the 19th century. And in war, politics is also an important weapon. The use of diplomacy was important to the Emirs, as she could meddle in the politics of her neighbors to her own advantage. There is abundant evidence to show that Ilorin dealt with Nupi by encouraging one faction there against the other. For example, Ilorin supported Nupi refugees in the Emirates, while at the same time changed Maji efforts to Rabat. With this action, the ruling elite in the Emirates combined diplomacy and warfare to achieve the desired objective. For over 4 decades of the 19th century, Ilorin pursued our interests in such a manner that Guangdong's interest was also accommodated, since both Ilorin and Nupi were under the overlordship of Guangdong within the political arrangements of the Sokoto Caliphate. Ilorin, like many other states, employed diplomacy as a weapon of interstate relations in an age when might was right. The essence of something which Ilorin had in 19th century Yoruba was a result of an open door policy to diplomatic avenues, if such would provide positive results. In reality, Ilorin was ready to take sides with Iba, a pitiless foe in Yoruba, when she felt recognized, and was prepared to abandon the alliance whenever it was thought fit to do so. And that was the balance, no permanent friends, no permanent enemies. Two examples will completely destroyed in 1865, and colonial government intervention made a prepare for war inconclusive. The employment of diplomacy was not a prisoner of the ruling elite. Ilorin citizens within and outside the Emirates were also involved in attempts to resolve issues affecting the Emirates through political channels. The failure of the agreement between NLD and National African Company, later rather, collapsed the cause of the interpretation given to the agreement by the National African Company that Ilorin was under their control. Became sour to the extent that the controversial visit of Governor of Lagos, Gilbert Carter, in 1883, did not improve relations. Accordingly, the people of Ilorin in Lagos cast their lots to mediate in the evolving crisis, with a view to restoring or at best improve the relations between the colonial government in Lagos and the Ilorin leadership. In this direction, a meeting which involved Lagos Muslims and prominent Ilorin allies in Lagos was held. The meeting was initiated by the colonial government in Lagos, which approached Muslims of Lagos to help resolve the matter. The outcome of the meeting was the sending of three missions by Lagos Muslim Committee to Ilorin between 1894 and 1896, with a view to bringing an end to the deadlock between the government of the Emirate and the colonial government in Lagos. I don't believe that they should be able to persuade their fellow Muslims to follow the path of peace. The failure of this mission eventually contributed to the bombardment of Ilorin and the Royal Niger Company in 1897. I then moved to 19th century Ilorin for economy. Other areas of the Sokoto Caliphate transacted business with the territories southwest of the Niger in the 19th century. The position of the Emirates, boosted our economy to a large extent, and to a large extent, gave our leverage to influence events in neighboring territories. The Emirates had a wide variety of resources. This included revenue from transportation, tributes from Emirates districts, booty from incessant Ilorin warfare, revenue accruing to the Emirates from the extensive network of traders. The revenue generated in Ilorin was determined by a combination of two factors. First, by regulations according to Sharia, and second, through by customary practices. In other words, the norms as embedded in the traditional culture of the large global population in the Emirates. Morelast assumed that Muslim law was important in the methods of tax collection in the Sokoto Caliphate. But as important as the law, as this one, there were differences in the revenue generated by each Emirate, while the form at which the revenue which Sokoto Caliphate received from the Emirate took. As far as Ilorin was concerned, this was how our southern neighbors, our southern districts, paid tributes to the leadership of Ilorin. Muslim law would also appear to be applicable to the sharing of booty collected during the military expeditions which the Ilorin Balogos carried out to defend and extend the frontiers of the Emirate during the first decade of the establishment of the Emirate. In the use of Muslim law, however, the Yoruba tradition of sharing such booty must also have informed. Thus, on the sharing of which, the Emirate was very close to the recommendation of Tupan Dankoli in Bayan Uju al-Ijra al-Alibad, in which he said that one fifth of a booty should be given to the Muslim ruler. In this case, the Emir would then distribute as he deemed fit. This evil followed Johnson's history, falls in line with his distribution of booty among Yoruba. In reality, this was almost the situation in Ilorin. The location of Ilorin, as mentioned earlier, made the area suitable for agriculture. There was large farming population producing all kinds of farm products, most especially foodstuff. These farmers also paid their taxes in kind, as oral sources suggest. The payment was done during the harvest season, like farmers, artisans, such as that is, weavers and workers involved in Ilorin indigenous industries such as cloth weaving, pottery making, and producers of household essentials also paid taxes to the emirates, mostly in Kano, although the use of cowries was reported later in the century. Reference has been made to the fact that Ilorin conducted several wars in the 19th century. These wars were mostly led by the Balogun's while the emirs stayed in the capital. Therefore, the Balogun were in charge of distributing the booty and they determined what portion should go to the emir. The arrangement, which, as noted earlier, is not against Islamic principles, partly explains the power enjoyed by the Balogun's were compared with them in the 19th century. In the domain of revenue generation, the Balogun's were having the greater share. However, it should be recalled that as leaders in their work, they also had enormous financial responsibilities. Ilorin Emirate expanded southwards and eastwards by warfare and adoption in the early years of the Emirate. This meant that all the areas brought within the fold of the Emirate became tribute-paying districts of the Emirate. These tributes were paid through Ilorin representatives in this district, who eventually passed on to the Balogun. The nature of the tributes paid depended on the resources of tribute-paying towns. They were usually made up of kola nuts, palm oil, cowries, slaves, and ropes of house building. It was the duty of the Balogun to pass the highest percentage of the tributes to the end. A portion of the tribute was spent on administration of the emirate, while the emir disposed what was due to him as he thought fit. In essence, though the emir might not be attached as some of the Balogun's, he was also in a position to control some wealth. Historians and scholars in related studies who have paid some attention to the Ilorin economy in the pre-colonial agree that the most important source of revenue for Ilorin Emirate in the century was from trade. The location of the Emirate capital on a very important trading axis facilitated promotion of trading relations from which the Emirate derived considerable profit. Travelers' accounts are replete with information about the degree of trade that was taking place in the Kambari market. Ilorin had trading connections with several towns further south. It also maintained a profitable long-distance trade with Kano, Sokoto, and Borno to the north. These trading networks had implications for markets at home. There was growth of markets with specialization in goods wanted by buyers. The Kambari market was an international market because it was frequented by long-distance traders. Items of trade in the market included horses and ox trappings, reportedly bought for sale from North Africa. Silk clothing, Arabian carpets, salt and spices. Slaves were recorded for sales in their hundreds. These slaves must have been procured in some of the military expeditions of Ilorin in the 19th century. The other traders of Ilorin also acted as middlemen by providing brokerage and lodging homes to long distance traders. Furthermore, the House of Kambarima War performed mediatory roles for various groups of trading traders in Ilorin. The result of this trading conflict was that Ilorin became wealthy and naturally the rulers of the emirate benefited from such work. Long distance trade did make Ilorin economy growing for most parts of the 19th century. Internal trade within the emirate was also a contributing factor to the buoyant economy. Each of the world's had markets under the control of the Balogun and their agents. This market dealt in local exchanges, most especially foodstuff and another attempt of rural consumption. What was more important, the market served as major links in the villages around the emirate capital, where produce were brought for sale. While markets provided a strong economic base of the emirate, it also served as a place of diffusion of culture, which was taking place in Ilorin throughout the 19th century. Indeed,